let's talk about vinyl. Now, I'm getting the new company car ready for action, and I started doing some vinyl work. Well, the problem is I got rid of my vinyl cutter a little while back because I just didn't have space for it, and I wasn't using it, and it was a big one, and I didn't really need such a big one anyway. So as I'm getting ready to get back into it and get some vinyl work done, I was like, I'll just buy a new one. I'll buy a small one. And then my wife was like, hey, just use my Cricut. And I was like, I don't know, man. I'm making cool vinyl stuff. Aren't Cricuts for making unicorns and butterflies and stuff? So, you know, what's funny about it is vinyl's vinyl and a vinyl cutter is a vinyl cutter. It doesn't really matter which one. Well, this is what's amazing. I started using my wife's Cricut and I was like, holy cow, this is a fantastic vinyl cutter. And what's really funny about it is the stupid Cricuts are like half the price of regular vinyl cutters. So I think it's the same concept as like printers. They want you to buy the printer for super cheap and then buy the printer ink. Well, you can get vinyl all over the place for super cheap. So you don't have to buy Cricut vinyl, and it still does perfect with this. So let me show you how to get started in vinyl, show you how cool it is and how easy it is. All right, let's talk about software, because this is where most folks get confused when they start to get into cutting vinyl. When you cut vinyl, you need to set your design up, and your design needs to be in what's called a vector format. The difference between a vector and a bitmap, or a regular picture that you're used to, is this. When I have a regular picture and I zoom into it really far, you can see you lose the detail. And so what you actually see is the map. You see a map of colors. So this gray square right here is probably at like 132 to the right and 172 up. So it's a grid, and that's how the computer sees it. But the computer loses the detail as it zooms in or as I make it bigger and smaller. Now, that's not the case with a vector. And the reason is because a computer sees a vector as actual lines and colors. It doesn't see it as a map. So it actually sees this line as a curve with a specific formula. And it sees this color as red, and it fills in these lines. That's it. So the cool thing about a vector is you can zoom in and out or make it bigger and smaller, and it never loses any detail because the computer sees it as lines, not as a map. Well, that's super important when you want to cut vinyl, and that's how the pros are doing it. They're bringing their designs into a vector program first before they bring it into their cutting program. Now, I'm going to show you the commercial version of, the Cricut software, and it looks a lot like a vector program, and it actually works like a vector program. But the catch is most cutting software can do vector stuff. It just can't do it very well. So, because, a fully featured vector program is, a lot more complicated than just cutting software. So it looks like a vector program, but it's really not. It's really just designed to translate shapes into cuts. So, what I need to do is go back to my vector program and get my vector ready to go. That's actually really easy. What I do is I set my background up the exact same size as my cutting surface, and then made my graphic fit within it, and then I simply cut the edges off. All right, from there, I just need to export it, and when I export it, I'm going to export it in what's called a scalable vector graphic format. This is the most common file type across all vector programs, and most vector programs can export into a ton of different things because you're going from a simple design to a more complex one, not the other way around. So you have all these options. Well, you want to just keep it in a scalable vector graphic format because it's so useful across all different types of software. So I'm just going to export this as a SVG, and that'll bring us to our next step. Okay, I have to admit, I had to film this part, this section, or sequence, a couple of times because Cricut software is so, it's definitely a little confusing, especially for the layperson.
So when you first go into CricutCut, and this is what happens with most cutting software, they want you to buy their designs, and they want you to use their base designs, and they charge you a little bit for them and stuff like that. The reality of it is, you don't need any of this. You already have your design, and you just want to go to the cutting part. So with CricutCut software, you can skip right over to that by going right here to Canvas, or you can go down here to New Project. So we're going to do New Project, and then this is what normal cutting software actually looks like. Now I want to pull my graphic into this workspace, and as you can see, just like in my vector program, it has inches on the top, inches on the bottom. That gives you all your scales, so you know exactly how big your shape is going to come out. Now, inside of CricutCut, you have to upload your graphic first. So I come over here, and notice it says SVG. That's because it's the most common file type, and it's always you can always use it. So I'm going to upload, browse, come over here, and grab my CD Big. Now, this is where CricutCut gets a little confusing, too. It looks like it's already up there, right? No, it's not uploaded yet. It says preparing. So I have to go over here and say upload. All right, now it's uploaded. Now I can go back to my workspace, which is confusing, but there it is right here. All right, now I want to pull in one of my images. It should say vector because it's really a vector I'm trying to pull in. But once again, CricutCut wants you to buy stuff. So here's a ton of stuff. Well, my design's in here somewhere. Well, it's pretty easy to find. If I just come over here, I figure this trick out. Ownership and ones that I've uploaded. So there it is. Now that I grab it, I thought, this should be simple. You should double click it. Nope, of course not. It's got some little gimmicky thing. So you click on it and then you come way over here to the right and say add to canvas. All right, now my graphic is in the canvas. Remember, almost all vector programs, including cutting software, you can zoom in and out using the scroll key or the scroll on your scroll wheel on your mouse and the control key if you hold them both down at the same time. Okay, as you can see, my graphic is not really set up because your cutter will usually cut up and down. So, and my cutter is only 12 inches across. So I need to make this design fit within 12 inches. So to make this fit within the 12 inches and then the 24, which is basically how I already have it set up, I need to rotate it. But I'm not going to use the little rotate button up here because I don't want to wing it. I want it to be perfect. So I go over here and to the rotate and I plug in 90 degrees. All right, now I should be good to go. Well, of course I'm not, because CricutCut kind of lies and it says you can cut out to 12 inches. But if I try to do this right now, it'll give me a warning because you can actually only go out to 11 and a half. So now what I need to do is I need to scale my image to fit within that 11 and a half space. So once again, a little quirky, I got to get over here where I can get the one place where I can scale it up and down. And I scale it down just a little bit. I want it to be a little under 11 and a half. So as you can see, it's just a tiny bit. Oop, not quite. Now it's just a tiny bit under. There's 11, 11 and a half. We should be good to go. Okay, from there, another little quirky thing about CricutCut I learned is right now it still sees this as separate shapes, and it wants to cut them, and it wants to arrange them. When I go to cut them, it wants to jumble them up and pack them in so I don't waste very much vinyl. Well, I don't need to do that because I want my design to be laid out exactly how I want it to go on my project. So I grab my design, come way over here to the right, and I click attach. Now everything is attached together. Now all I have to do is go over to make it, and pretty much I'm ready to go. It gives you some weird warnings I've noticed. But as long as you're within what you're supposed to be within, it works fine. So I've obviously got my material size set up correctly. I want the correct amount of copies. Then I hit continue. It connects to the cutter. It sees that my base material is vinyl, and this is actually set on my cutter itself. It's just a dial, and you just hit, you click it over to vinyl. And then this is everything that's already loaded on my cutter, so I am good to go. Then I load my mat in, and then it's ready to go. All I have to do is now I actually start the cutting on my cutter.
Okay, now we're ready to cut. Now let me show you one of the biggest frustrations with vinyl cutters and what freaks people out and they get super frustrated. What it is has to do with how your blade is set up. Understand that the blade inside of a vinyl cutter, all it is a tiny like little X-Acto blade that spins, so, and it spins freely. So whenever the head moves around, it's like somebody dragging an X-Acto blade over your vinyl. Now, the height of that blade is what frustrates a ton of people. And it doesn't matter what kind of vinyl cutter you have to make sure that that height is good. Now, you adjust that height depending on what type of material you're gonna cut. Well, when it comes to vinyl, a good rule of thumb is about half the width of a credit card. Now, that's a pretty easy one to use, and the reason is, it's because what you're looking at is somewhere around half a millimeter. So if you need to just grab your, you know, ruler and remember what a millimeter looks like, and then go about half a millimeter, that's usually pretty good. The pressure is not as huge of a deal, and it helps tremendously if you use a mat. A lot of vinyl cutters don't actually use mats, but they actually do help. And the reason they help is you don't really need it, but it makes the setup a lot more forgiving. So if your blade's off by a little bit or the pressure's off by a little bit, a mat will save you. And that's why you see mats with almost all the entry-level vinyl cutters, because it enables you to take a vinyl cutter that's not set up perfectly and it'll still cut really well. So let me show you what I'm talking about when it comes to the blade. So if I come way down here and I look, there's the blade, you see it? And that needs to be about half a millimeter. So I've got my vinyl ready to go. What I did was I cut it to fit on top of my mat. And what I also did was I made sure that it didn't overlap over the edges, because the way this cutter works, you don't want it extra wide at all because it won't fit correctly. This one's designed and it's got the little guides on the sides right here. So you don't want your vinyl to overlap because it'll change it or it'll change the angle that it's going in. The biggest thing about vinyl cutters, doesn't matter whether it's a cheap one or an expensive one, your vinyl needs to go in there square. So that's one of the parts that you want to really take a little extra time and make sure that you do correctly. I have to admit, I kind of like this. The Cricut actually pulls your mat into there for you. So it's pretty cool. So now it's good. Alright, so I'm good to go, and I like how the Cricut kind of spits it out for you. Now, we're going to go into a process which is called weeding. So we're going to pull the sticker part off of the design that we don't want. What's really cool is, I have to admit, Cricut comes with these cool little tools that pros use to weed. So I have to admit, that's pretty convenient. Instead of having to go buy these are really cool because it helps you pull the sticker up. Okay, so all you do is you take your transfer paper and you cover your whole project. So trying to do this with one hand is a little tricky, but it can't really set up. When it comes to transfer paper, you don't have to be perfect, but close is usually pretty good. So you put your transfer paper down on here, and basically what you want is transfer paper to stick to the sticker and the vinyl and not the backing. That way when we peel it off, now we have a clear base to put our entire vinyl sticker on. So this is where having done this a few times helps tremendously. This is a plastic ruler, but it's one of the nicer ones, so it's really stiff. If you can't find one of these, just find a metal ruler. They work pretty well too. The concept here is that vinyl, trying to get it to peel when you want it to peel and not peel when you don't want it to peel, can be a challenge. But the trick is to use really sharp angles. And that's why using a ruler during this process helps tremendously. So what I'm going to do is what I'm trying to do is I'm getting the sticker to stick to the transfer tape, but not to the sticker backing. And this is by far the easiest way I've found to do this. See how I'm peeling it really, really sharply away? So I'm peeling it in that direction, but I'm using the super sharp edge of the ruler, and I'm keeping a lot of pressure down on the ruler at the same time. By far, see how it still wanted to come up right there? By far the easiest way I've found to be able to do this. Really maintain that edge. Oh. And you should be good. So we are good.
Exactly.
Once I have my sticker on, I'm gonna do the exact same thing I just did. And obviously to get the sticker to stick to my project without it peeling up. See how it wants to peel up? Just go really slow and use that really hard edge pushing down, and that will help you get the sticker to stick to your project and not to the transfer paper. That's the trick. Again, not a huge amount of little tricks here. I will tell you one thing, as soon as you get anywhere close, static electricity is going to want to pull it towards where it needs to go. So I mean, it's going to pull it up against your project. So you really want to make sure you've got it where you want it. Pretty good idea what it takes to get started using vinyl and using a vinyl cutter. So I found a fantastic deal on the model of Cricut I actually have, and I'll put the link in the description if you're looking for one, and it's cheaper than most of the nice vinyl cutters out there, the no-name brands too. So definitely check that out if you're interested. So I hope you learned that vinyl can be a little tricky at first, but once you learn those few little tricks, man, it could be awesome, and you could make some really professional looking stuff. So I hope you've enjoyed this video, and if you've got any questions, you know where to check us out. CommandoDesigns.com. I'm Tony.